Banthas were a genus of large, horned mammals native to the deserts of Tatooine. The most prevalent species, the common bantha, was introduced to other planets and over the course of many decades evolved into six distinct subspecies, including the dwarf and the dune bantha. The bantha is one of the handful of creatures in Star Wars that has been given an official scientific name, so in case you're as big of a nerd as I am, their binomial nomenclature is Bantha majoris. The nominate subspecies, your standard run-of-the-mill bantha, is the only one we see in the movies, so that's one I will be focusing on. According to Wikipedia, the average bantha could grow to about 2.3 meters tall and weigh up to 4,000 kilograms, which is actually pretty scientifically accurate. Now, in case you're unsure of how I can tell the dimensions of a fictional mammal, I can tell you because the bantha that we see in A New Hope is actually portrayed by an Asian elephant. Her name was Margie, and she lived at a park called Marine World Africa, despite being neither marine nor African, but it was the 70s, who really cares about anything? Anywho, she actually ended up playing both banthas, and even shot on location in Death Valley, wearing a costume that looks like the love child of Mr. Snuffleupagus and a bighorn sheep, so mad props to her. And that wasn't even her only contribution to the Star Wars universe, as they used her pattern of walking as the basis of my personal favorite vehicle in Star Wars, the AT-AT Walker. Back to the bantha, a lot of their ecology is very clearly based off of that of elephants, most notably being their remarkable intelligence, the fact that they live in female herds that are led by a matriarch, possessing a prehensile trunk-like tongue, and forming close bonds with those that domesticate them. Bogwings were a species of flying creature native to the wetlands, swamps, and bogs of Dagobah, hence the name. Bogwings are the first example of a new class of animals in Star Wars, the Reptavians, which refers to a creature that possesses both reptile and avian traits, so essentially a dinosaur. Anywho, going back to the Bogwing, they are able to carry prey that is heavier than they are, probably in part to their large talons, and similar to your typical bird of prey, they often feed on smaller animals, mostly rodents, bats, and lizards. Bogwings are split into two distinct subspecies, the greater and the lesser, which are able to be differentiated between by their size and their habitats, with the greater often being found in the canopies, while the lesser prefers to hunt in the understory as well as on the forest floor. Dagobah pythons were, surprise surprise, a species of python endemic to Dagobah that were able to swallow prey 15 times their own body weight, which put species like the reticulated python and the green anaconda to shame. An individual appears during the Cave of Evil, where it's portrayed by a boa constrictor. Boas and pythons are a great example of convergent evolution, which is the biological phenomenon where two species that are in different regions or different time periods evolve to have similar features. These two are both predatory constrictors, however they inhabit different parts of the world, with pythons inhabiting sub-Saharan Africa, southern Asia, Australia, and the various islands throughout the Pacific, whereas boas are found in the Americas, Eastern Europe, the Middle East, Northern Africa, and whatever islands the pythons aren't on. Dubecs were large quadrupedal reptiles native to Tatooine, in particular the Dune Sea, that bear a striking resemblance to the lizards of Earth. The name Dubec comes from the water that accumulates on their back while they're sleeping, which they use as a source of hydration. Unlike most species of reptile that we're familiar with, Dubecs seem to be a relatively social animal and form groups that share their dew with others, as well as sleep in a large pile in order to conserve body heat. Speaking of heat, their coloration is said to contain specialized pigments that reduce the glare of the twin suns, allowing them to conserve fluid. Similar to other species on Tatooine, they are easily domesticated and used as mounts to cross the desert. Although appearing slow and sluggish, they can occasionally run into bursts of up to 50 kilometers an hour, which is approximately the same as a grizzly bear. In case that doesn't sound that impressive, a thoroughbred racehorse averages around 40-ish kilometers an hour. Yikes. Dianogas were hermaphroditic, one-eyed aquatic mollusks that could often be found in garbage treatment facilities and were rumored to originate from the planet Vodran, although this claim is yet to be proven. While they appear similar to the cephalopods of Earth, they only possessed six arms and had several large teeth rather than one solid beak, even though it is located at the center of their body, much like an octopus or a squid. They are notably difficult to get rid of due to their immunity to pollution and most toxins, something that a lot of Earth species would kill for. A fully grown Dianoga could reach lengths of up to 20 meters wide and were able to eat almost anything, including toxic waste, as well as members of their own species. Dragon snakes were a large species of reptile that possessed a strong, propulsive tail and were native to the wetlands, swamps, and other similar ecosystems across multiple planets. Unlike the snakes of Earth, dragon snakes possess a pair of arms, which they would use to grab prey, as well as to beach themselves onto exposed rocks in order to warm up, since they were cold-blooded. The prey of these supersized serpents can vary, as they typically tend to eat anything from fish to reptiles and even metals, which explains why one tried to eat R2-D2 in Episode 5. While they first appeared in The Empire Strikes Back, we got our first official look at a dragon snake in an episode of The Clone Wars where one attempted to eat Obi-Wan Kenobi. It is worth pointing out that the dragon snakes on Nal Hutta may be different species, since they do not possess the front limbs that are seen on those from Dagobah. Exogorths, also known as space slugs, were large, worm-like creatures that were able to grow more than 900 meters long that would burrow into asteroids and anchor themselves to the rock in order to gain nutrients from it, using a vast system of mineral-leaching tendrils. Similarly to a species that we will see later on in this episode, they were composed of a silicon-like element rather than carbon, which, in case you're unfamiliar, is essentially literally everything on Earth. This allowed them to evolve unorthodox methods of surviving, including being able to live in the vacuum of space and reproducing by a fission. In case you aren't familiar with the concept of fission, don't worry, neither am I. Frog dogs were surprisingly neither frog nor dog, but a species of lizard that possessed two limbs and an anglerfish-like jaw. Despite their nightmarish mouth, their diet primarily consisted of insects. They may have gotten the frog part of their name by their amphibian-like mating call, as well as their head, and received the dog part from their ease of which they were domesticated. While the greater crate dragon does appear in Episode 4 as a skeleton, it will be discussed in a later episode as it is much more prevalent in the series. Greks were carnivorous mammals that inhabited the forest moon of Endor that possessed a pair of Babirusa-like tusks that extended up from the upper jaw. The only one seen on screen was a carcass that was used as a headdress by the Ewok Tebow, in the similar style to how Native Americans would wear animals like bison or cougars. Personally, I feel like using an animal jawbone with extremely pronounced incisors as a hat isn't the brightest idea from a safety standpoint, but who am I to judge the style choices of an alien teddy bear? Oh boy. Green iguanas, or as they're known scientifically, iguana iguana, are a species of lizard that are native to the tropical regions of the Americas that range from southern Mexico to Paraguay. They are a very successful species as they've been able to escape from captivity and establish large populations in the southern US, Hawaii, Puerto Rico, and apparently the forest moon of Endor, as Chief Chirpa, the Ewok, has an iguana as both a pet and an advisor. I am at a complete loss for words. Why is the lizard his advisor? What does he advise on? Do Ewoks have a centralized government? Do they collect taxes? Do they have their own currency? What's their economy like? Do they have social services? What about healthcare? You know what? I'm just going to move on with what's left of my sanity because we have a lot more species to go through. Gerbas, not to be confused with gerboas, were large pack animals native to Tatooine. Despite appearing to be a beast of burden that would closely resemble a yak, apparently they're equids. Yeah, this is supposed to be a horse in Star Wars. Despite being raised for their meat, milk, and leather, just like yaks, they're apparently supposed to be space horses. Anywho. Clatooine paddy frogs were a species of amphibian native to the wetlands of Clatooine. Not much is known about this frog, but apparently they were a delicacy throughout the galaxy, but then again, it was Jabba the Hutt who said it, so take it with a grain of salt. The Star Wars fandom has plenty to spare.
Salt.
Kowakian monkey lizards were a highly intelligent species of reptile native to the tropical rainforests of Kowak. Hence the name, they share many similar features with monkeys, most predominantly their long limbs. Monkey lizards also possessed opposable digits, which allowed them to live an arboreal lifestyle and even hold and use weapons such as vibroblades and blasters. This species can appear in a wide variety of colors, including brown, red, and a pattern that suspiciously resembles a blue and yellow macaw. Speaking of macaws, monkey lizards also have beaks, which allow them to eat insects and other smaller animals. Arguably, the most famous member of this species was Salacious B. Crumb, who is also arguably the most attractive character in all of Star Wars. I'm just kidding. It's Kedpin Schlopkop. Regardless of whether or not you consider him to be a certified hunk, Mr. Crumb was, quote-unquote, employed by Jabba the Hutt as his court jester before his untimely demise after a group of intergalactic terrorists blew up his sail barge. Salacious B. Crumb, you may be gone, but you will live on in our hearts. Minox were a silicon-based bat-like parasite that often shoot through the power cables of starships, but predominantly sustain themselves off of the food eaten by their hosts. Now, there are several different species which can be differentiated by additional wings, appendages, or even mouths, but they are all silicon-based life forms which are able to survive in harsh environments, including the digestive tract of exogorths, as well as the vacuum of space. And much like the giant slug that they often live in, they are able to reproduce via fission. Once again, no idea what that means, sounds complicated. Nudges were a species of lizard native to Dagobah. It was portrayed by a real-life lizard in Episode 5 and hasn't reappeared in Star Wars since. I would like to propose a theory that this iguana is the same iguana that plays the advisor of the Ewoks, but that's just a theory. Apparently, they were also extremely responsive to the Force, but then again, isn't everything? Rancors were large bipedal carnivores native to Dathomir, Felucia, and countless other planets. While reading up about them, I noticed that many sources call them reptomammals. So according to me, they're synapsids. In case you're unfamiliar with that clade of vertebrates, synapsids are mammals and any species that was more closely related to a mammal than any other animal, like diectodonts, gorgonopsids, dimetrodon, so on and so forth. Rancors were able to stand at heights of up to 4 meters tall and weigh up to 1,600 kilograms. There are multiple subspecies of rancor, including the nominate, the jungle, the rage, and the pygmy, however, only the first two have been seen in canon media. In Episode 5 of The Bad Batch, we are introduced to Muchi, a juvenile rancor who is very interesting in terms of rancor behavior. They have a social hierarchy that is led by an alpha rancor, and the individuals determine their status through strength and fighting. So the position of alpha isn't determined by relationships and bloodlines, but by combat. Apparently, rancors can also be easily subdued if you're beating the daylights out of them, but then again, that's the same for most species. Unrelated and unimportant, they're my favorite creature in Star Wars, probably because the first movie that I have any recollection of watching was Return of the Jedi. Rock warts were venomous parasites that could be found all throughout the Dune Sea. They possessed 4 eyes and 8 legs, which is about twice as many as you really need. They are also known for a rather unusual method of raising their young. Expecting rockworts would kill another animal using their neurotoxic bite and lay their eggs inside of them. Once again, this alien behavior has a basis in the real world, as tarantula hawks will do the same thing, except their babies eat the host from the inside out, while the animal is still alive. Isn't nature beautiful? Rontos were large, 4-eared, 4-legged reptilians native to the deserts of Tatooine, which are essentially the Star Wars version of a giraffe, which is to be expected from an animal whose height is 50% neck. When wanting to demonstrate their fitness for a potential mate, they will use their necks to do the talking, whacking them into each other at near terminal velocity and utilizing their bumpy skull as a makeshift battering ram. In addition to using their necks to beat each other up, they would also use it in the expected purpose, feeding. Rontos were herbivores and would often feed on lichen and mosses that would grow on the walls of canyons. Sand scritters were small, rodent-like mammals endemic to Tatooine. Similar to their squirrely earth relatives, they predominantly fed on plants, in particular the shoots. Unlike rodents, they possessed 4 eyes, which leads to my crackpot conspiracy theory that they are a close relative of the Nexu, but I'll get more into that when I try to classify all these creatures in the future. Despite how crazy my theory may sound to you, just remember that looks are deceiving since the Hyrax is the closest living relative of the elephant. Sarlacc were colossal predatory arthropods that bury themselves as infants in order to create a large crater and feed off of any poor unfortunate organism that happens to fall into their open maw. Sarlaccs had rather long lifespans, able to live for several millennia, as evidenced by the fact that they take over 1,000 years to fully digest their prey. They are confirmed to be arthropods, despite having multiple similarities with cephalopods, with the most notable being, of course, their tentacles and large beaks. The most infamous individual was a female who resided in the Great Pit of Carcoon. Yes, the one that briefly ate Boba Fett was a female, as the males are only a fraction of the size and are parasitic. After mating, they will fuse to the female and eventually become absorbed by her. While that sounds crazy, this is yet another example of Star Wars adapting real-life animal behavior, as this is actually how anglerfish mate. Scurriers were small, bipedal, desert-dwelling mammals native to Tatooine. These little critters are essentially a hybrid of an armadillo and a kangaroo. A kangadillo, if you will. Since they hop on their back legs, use their arms to burrow, and have armor-like platings along their back. They have first appeared in the Special Edition re-release as CGI little cretins running around Mos Eisley, but thanks to their appearance in Obi-Wan Kenobi, we now know much more about them. For starters, there is sexual dimorphism between the males and females, as males possess a small pair of antlers. Selenes were a large species of lizard that inhabited the swamps of Dagobah. Interestingly enough, many canon sources say that they predominantly fed off of insects, even though it was portrayed by an Asian water monitor, which is a famously carnivorous lizard. While most species of monitor are predatory, there, of course, are exceptions to the rule, like the graze monitor, which eats almost exclusively fruit. So there is a possibility that the selene is insectivorous, however, I find that unlikely. Oy. Tattoo rats were a species of rat native to Tatooine. That's basically it. Come on, there are like 5 animals left in this video, give me a break. Tauntauns were a genus of bipedal reptomammals, synapsids, that were native to Hoth's tundras. The most common species was the common or the giant tauntaun, which we were introduced to in episode 5. They were extremely well adapted to their environment, coming equipped with dense fur, small ears, specialized nostrils that would allow them to heat the air before they breathed it in, and a thick layer of blubber. While the various species of tauntaun were all different and unique in their own ways, they all shared a common trait, their horns. All of them possessed some variation of a pair of sheep-like horns, which were probably made up of keratin, which is a protein that is commonly found throughout nature. Famous examples include the horns of rhinoceros, bird beaks, turtle shells, gazelle horns, as well as your own hair and fingernails. A good rule of thumb in zoology is, if you have no idea what it is, it's probably keratin. Christ on a bike. Tip-yips, or the Endorian chicken, were a domesticated species of avian native to the forest moon of Endor. They bear a striking resemblance to the silky and Polish chicken breeds of Earth, mostly because they were portrayed by them. I don't really know what else to say, it is just a chicken. Verkles were a species of rodent native to the forest moon of Endor, and when I said that the Rancor was my favorite, I may have spoke too soon, as the Verkel kind of takes the cake for this reason and this reason only. So if you're unfamiliar with it, it's the dead animal that Chewbacca grabs that causes the rebels to get caught in the Ewok trap. So the production needed a puppet, so they literally glued fake teeth onto the anus of a white-tailed deer pelt. So this creature is essentially a pair of dentures superglued on top of venison. Well, I guess technically on bottom. Wampas were large quadrupedal reptomammals endemic to Hoth. Being both the largest species on the planet and well-adapted for their environment, these Sasquatch wannabes were the apex predator of their ecosystem. Their preferred prey of choice was often tauntauns, which they share a pair of similar horns with, although they are not closely related. When hunting, they could actively switch back between running on their hind limbs as well as on all fours. Sadly, they were not Force-sensitive, so there is no chance of creating a Jedi Order. I'll see myself out. Warts were large quadrupedal desert-dwelling amphibians that called Tatooine their home. Similarly to the frogs and toads of Earth, they used their long sticky tongue to grab their prey from a distance. Unlike our amphibian friends, these Tatooine toads were actually venomous. Their teeth possessed a high level of toxins that they would use to incapacitate any unlucky insect, reptile, or mammal that crossed their path. Friendly reminder that poison and venom are not the same thing. Poison ingests, venom injects. Suffice to say that if you are bitten and you die, it's venomous, but if you bite it and you die, it's poisonous. And that is all of the species of animal that we see in the original trilogy. Thank you all so much for watching, and if you'd like to see me cover the rest of the fauna, flora, and fungi of a galaxy far, far away, please consider subscribing. It really goes a long way in supporting the channel, and it lets me know that you want to see content from me. Even if you don't subscribe, I hope you have a good rest of your day, and may the Force be with you.